We have a lot of interesting stuff to talk about this week, from vending machines with facial recognition that spy on you while you're buying M&Ms, to an embarrassing week for Google and their AI pursuits, plus malware on the Ubuntu store. Again, let's talk about it. So, did you hear about this? Vending machines are now tracking you. According to a report by the University of Waterloo's Math News, their on-campus M&M vending machines are apparently spying on their students and faculty. In their investigation, Math News reporter Firsty found that the vending machine's owner, Adara Vending Services, was not fully aware of the machine's capabilities in this regard. But the manufacturer of the machine, Invenda Solutions, said, quote, "The software conducts local processing of digital image maps derived from the USB optical sensor in real time without storing such data on permanent memory mediums or transmitting them over the internet to the cloud. It is imperative to note that Invenda software does not possess the capability to recognize any individual's identity or any other form of personal information." But the frequently asked questions for the machine states, quote, "Only the final data, namely presence of person, estimated age, and estimated gender, is collected without any association to an individual." Question: do Invenda clients exclusively obtain anonymized analytical outcomes, such as usage frequency within specific demographic trends, sales statistics, etc.? Answer: clients are furnished with anonymized data analysis. So the owner of the vending machine says that they're not capable of taking or storing images. Yeah, it's clear that that's either uninformed or intentionally deceitful. I would lean towards the former, as most people don't really know how computers work, especially the CEO of a vending machine business. I mean, computers might as well be black boxes full of magic. So if we're to believe that what the manufacturer has to say about this, the facial recognition is done locally, and the quote, "anonymized reports are never sent over the web." But I mean, give me a break. The idea that it doesn't send anything over the web strains credulity to me. Now, this just goes to show that there are cameras everywhere, and you can really never be too cautious when it comes to preserving your privacy. I went down like a pretty deep rabbit hole when I was reading about this news story, and I found these like glasses that reflect infrared light. I kind of want these a lot right now. Not sponsored, by the way. I just found these and I thought they were cool. So Google, who released their AI chat companion Bard last year, have rolled out the new branding, as is tradition. And no, it's not Clippy, it's called Gemini. And as we've seen many, many times, Google just wants to make everything as confusing as possible. The CEO of Google Cloud, Thomas Kurian, I hope I said that right, said, quote, "We're announcing Duet AI for Google Workspace will now be Gemini for Google Workspace. Consumers and organizations of all sizes can access Gemini across the workspace apps they know and love." So to sum up the situation over at Google, here's a reply to that tweet. "Hey Thomas, can I pay for it with Google Pay in Google Wallet, which replaced Google Pay, which replaced Android Pay, formerly known as Google Wallet? If not, can we jump on a call to discuss billing? I'll send you an invite on Google Meet, the enterprise Google Chat, previously Duo, which replaced Allo, the replacements for Hangout, the rebrand of Plus Hangouts, which replaced Talk and Voice." Ugh. That is so true, it hurts. And I mean, Gemini did some pretty embarrassing stuff, but I'm actually not gonna talk about it here on YouTube because I don't wanna get demonetized. So if you wanna see the extended version of this episode, head over to my streaming site, subscribe2.me. There'll be a link down below. You can interact with my videos there using your existing Mastodon, PixelFed, or PeerTube accounts, and you can even subscribe there with your favorite podcast app or RSS reader. It's completely free, and that's due to the generosity of my patrons. I wouldn't be able to host this site and keep up with the high bandwidth demands if it weren't for them. So if you believe in independent media, you can make a pledge on Patreon. There's going to be a link in the pinned comment to the extended cut of this video, as well as my Patreon, where you can help the show grow. It's all greatly appreciated. So the US Energy Information Administration has initiated a survey of electrical consumption for cryptocurrency mining operations within the US, and I'm actually excited to see the results here. Beginning next week, the EIA will be sending out these surveys to commercial cryptocurrency miners, and they will be required to respond with details of their energy usage. About the survey, EIA Administrator Joe DeCarolis, I hope I said that right too, said, quote, "We intend to continue to analyze and write about the energy implications of cryptocurrency mining activities within the United States. We will specifically focus on how the energy demands for cryptocurrency mining is evolving, identify geographic areas of high growth, and quantify the sources of electricity used to meet cryptocurrency mining demands." And honestly, I think this is a great idea. I think that it makes sense to have this kind of business census out in the wild. Making informed database decisions is something that the government needs to do. And speaking of crypto scams, all right, our main story today, at least one Snapcraft IO user has lost over $500,000 in cryptocurrency stolen by a malicious app distributed through Canonical's Snap channels. An app called Exodus, posing as a local crypto wallet, was published to the Snap store. Now, the screenshots here seem to show a professional, fresh-looking app, and even some well-written marketing copy. And it looked to be a Snap repackage of a reputable crypto wallet. Notably, the Ubuntu App Center entry for this app showed a safe badge with a confirmed subheading. One might reasonably mistake that to mean that there was no risk to using the software, but that badge probably only indicates that there were no known malicious signatures detected. So when Snapcraft forum user Castle asked, "Can anyone tell me if the Exodus wallet in Ubuntu's software store is a scam? My wallet is empty after recovering it, and it shows a recent transaction of my entire balance sent to an address. I never made this transaction." Well, you can bet that it caught the attention of Alan Pope. Now, you may know him as Popey. He used to work for Canonical on the Snap team, but now he's, quote, "just a guy who wants Snapcraft to be a success." So Popey, being once a part of the Snap team, decided to dig into the malicious software, and he found that significant differences between the app distributed to the Snap store and the authentic app distributed to the official website. First, the Snap version was written in Flutter, while the authentic version was an Electron app. After further investigation, it looked like this app had a few other red flags that violated Exodus's OPSEC. The scam app asked for the user's 12-word phrase to unlock the wallet, which Exodus explicitly says they would never ask for. Which, you know, big red flag right there. And apparently, after typing in information, it would ping an API to check if the wallet was actually unlocked. If the wallet was unlocked, it's speculated that it would then exfiltrate your cryptocurrency. But this isn't the first time malicious software has been published on the Snapcraft store. In 2018, a non-consensual crypto miner was found hidden in a game and was sending crypto to a user going by the name myfirstferrari@protonmail.com. And there are several other scams like this too. In 2023, a fake version of Ledger Live was published to the store, and a user lost about $10,000 worth of cryptocurrency. So there's a problem with the Snap store. People are losing their fake money, and this guy lost 9 Bitcoin due to this scam app. So what can be done? Well, Mark Shuttleworth, the CEO of Canonical, has proposed a few ideas about how to address the issue. Quote, "One thing that we could do is to require a more comprehensive proof of publisher identity for every publisher. We could require a credit card, and we could integrate the sort of know-your-client technology that app-based banks are using to verify some sort of ID, such as a passport." But I feel like that is a bit of over-engineering for this problem. What if Snap packages needed to provide proof of ownership? For example, Git repos must match the contents of the Snap. Maybe have DNS TXT records updated that have some kind of provided signature that proves your ownership of the domain. And maybe some kind of hash on the download page for a Snap package that has to match the Snap you're trying to distribute on the Snap store. Then have real human auditors research the app in question and check that these proofs are in place. It's not a perfect system and it might not completely eliminate problems like this, but I think it's a long way towards getting there. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this, either my suggestion or the situation over at Snapcraft. Sound off in the comments below to feed that engagement algorithm. You can also like that smash button and get subscribed to stay up to date with all the fun stuff that we're doing here on the channel. That's all the tech news I wanted to talk about today. I'll see you guys in the next one.